Subhanallah wa bihamdihi rubbil alamin. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi rubbil alamin. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi.
Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us ease and with peace and health and safety. Allah ta'ala has allowed us to reach to the final moments of Ramadan. And Allah ta'ala has given us great, great rewards during this month of Ramadan. Such rewards that we cannot recognize here in this world. Inshallah, in the hereafter, when we see the gifts and rewards of Allah, then we will realize that how valuable was Ramadan for us. Ramadan, to attain Ramadan, most definitely for people like us, sinners, wrongdoers, it was difficult to attain the benefits of Ramadan. But Allah Ta'ala's rahmah, Allah's mercy, and with His power, with His karam, with His blessings, He has allowed us to benefit from His beautiful month. Otherwise, in reality, we are not capable of the things that Allah Ta'ala has given us. From the beginning, Allah Ta'ala's mercy, His grace, His generosity has remained with us. That from the first day, Allah Pak, from the beginning, the first day of Ramadan, us sinners, Allah Ta'ala allowed us to be introduced to Ramadan, that when we heard about the moon, the new moon, and we were doing dhikr in the house of Allah, in the masjid. And today, likewise, alhamdulillah, when Ramadan is passing and the sun is setting and Shawwal's moon is rising, then Allah Ta'ala has also allowed us to sit in another masjid, in another one of His homes, and sat us down so that we can remember Him. So we should pay attention, be alert, look at Allah Ta'ala's rahmah. And it's obvious that all we can see is that those individuals, those people, and especially such women and men in the whole world who are online listening and taking part in these majalis, in these gatherings, and alhamdulillah, from the first majlis and today, they are also present and included and listening to the majlis. For all of them is a beautiful, unique piece of good news that Rabbul Izzat Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbul Kareem, merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in such a way, in such a nice way, has given us great, great ni'mas. That in the beginning of Ramadan we were doing dhikr, when the moon of Ramadan was sighted, and the end of Ramadan we are also concluding with Allah Ta'ala's dhikr. So Allah Ta'ala's karam, His mercy and blessings and rahmah tell us this, that when you are attaining Allah's rahmah in the beginning and at the end, you are concluding the month with Allah Ta'ala's rahmah and with this amal, then Allah Ta'ala's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has spoken about this deed, dhikr, that those people, men and women who do dhikr in Ramadan, throughout Ramadan, they are forgiven. They are forgiven, and they are not just forgiven, but that's just one reward. But all the du'as they ask for, Allah Ta'ala says, I accept those du'as. So this is a very piece of good news. Alhamdulillah. That we came into Ramadan with dhikr, and we end Ramadan with dhikr. And then everything in between, inshallah, is accepted and qabool. And there's forgiveness. So after getting such a great ni'mah of Allah, then we should be grateful to Allah, extremely grateful. So I will request that the more we do Allah Ta'ala shukr, the more we are grateful that such a start of Ramadan, such an end, because we are not capable, we are not deserving. Otherwise it's difficult to understand the beauty of Ramadan. So the beginning was beautiful, the end was brilliant, and in between was brilliant. Allah Ta'ala has given us dhikr in the most precious hours. And we've heard all our lives the fadail, that what is it said about the action of dhikr and the rank of dhikr and the reward of dhikr. And in such a month in Ramadan, in such beautiful hours, Allah Ta'ala gave us the tawfiq to do His dhikr. So we we done away with laziness, we done away with excuses, we done away with the traveling and all the excuses. We reduced the hours of work, and for hours we sat down doing Allah Ta'ala's dhikr. People, while they were enjoying sleeping, snoring, Allah Ta'ala with His fadl and karam allowed us at those times to be sitting in His dhikr, in His remembrance. So this is Allah Ta'ala's fadl, His karam, and this is due to the du'as of the elders, our pious predecessors. I will say that this is the result of my Shaykh Hazrat Rahmatullah Noor Al-Marqada. May Allah Ta'ala shower down Noor, His special Noor, onto his grave. Such special Noor that will be given in Jannah. Because this is the fadl and karam of Allah. And their attention and focus and vision that they had for us. And they taught us, and due to their barakat and their blessings we sit. And this is the big reward. I know I'm repeating, but this is a big reward that Allah Ta'ala has given us. We should be very, extremely grateful. The more a person gets from Allah, the more he should be grateful. So what is the best way to do Allah Ta'ala shukr? What is the best, the highest way to do Allah Ta'ala shukr? Allah Ta'ala has given different ways of doing things. That, for example, a person who does tawbah, the people who have repented and they're sitting, Allah Ta'ala will give them high level maqam, spiritual, in this group of people. Otherwise, where will people come from? This gathering that we go to the wali, the friends of Allah, Allah Ta'ala says, like we say in the dua, Allah Ta'ala give us the darajat. Where do we get the darajat from? The levels from? The status from? Allah knows best that there will be brothers sitting here in this gathering who are honest, sincere, whose hearts have bowed to Allah, who will have done tawbah. And they would have rejected their sins, and they are living in this world, they would have finished with haram and unlawful things. Then of course they have qadr for Allah, and Allah Ta'ala in turn has qadr for them. So imagine their status Allah Ta'ala would have given them in Ramadan. How will I increase their levels? The people who came out from the dunya and became wali Allah or abdal, and the stamp of approval would have come on their life and destiny, not just for forgiveness, but their darajat have been increased. So Allah Ta'ala selects every year. These are the gatherings in which Allah Ta'ala selects in Ramadan. And Allah Ta'ala increases their rank. Allah increases their darajat. There's a person who's a sinner. He enters into Ramadan. And he understands the message of Ramadan. And after that, his whole feeling and actions through Ramadan are like those of the awliya Allah. His amal, his deeds are good. He pushes himself. He rectifies himself. He improves himself. This was what the wali's will have one day. From morning till evening, they'd sit in the khanka, do dhikr, do maraqabah. Remember Allah, Allah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. They would remember himself from the same way Allah Ta'ala picks the people from the dunya. A person who's unfortunate, who doesn't understand, then they go further away. For example, there's a statement that a person who has the company of the sheikh, of the teacher, and he doesn't change, he has the tawfiq to do dhikr, and his heart doesn't become soft, and he gets Ramadan and he doesn't attain forgiveness, then he is the biggest loser in the world. There's a hadith on this line as well, that there's no bigger loser than that person who doesn't attain the benefits of Ramadan. But the best and luckiest person is he who attains these three things. Did Allah Ta'ala not give us these three things? Company of the Shaykh, continuous, whatever it is, whatever he is, but you consider him as a Shaykh, so Allah will give you on that level that somebody can get from a great Shaykh. So if a person sits with this niyam, that I'm sitting with my Shaykh, with my teacher, alhamdulillah, whether he sits with Ghawth al-Adam, or with Mujaddid al-Afthani, or with any person, but when he sits with the Shaykh, he will get the same sohbat, the same company, the same rewards, the same effects. This is not the case that Allah Ta'ala differentiates. Even if the Shaykh is an empty box inside, but the student's niyyah is correct, so he will attain the same benefits as those people who were treated by Allah when they sat with the mashayikh or the pious predecessors. So alhamdulillah, in this vicinity you've seen a Shaykh, you've sat down, Allah says, fine, and I will call you and give you the reward in the same way. Just like those people who attained all the benefits and the great rewards when they sat with the wali's wala, Allah says, you'll get the same. Allah says, this is between me and you, I will give to you. So my situation is different, and obviously I speak to myself, but mashallah, you've come to my company, you said, this person, we want to sit with him. Doesn't matter how broken down he is, we'll sit, we'll benefit from him somehow. And we could not see anybody else. Alhamdulillah, we got this person broken down. And at least through his company, you've learned something and you've succeeded. So sohbat, if you got with a Ghaus or a Qutb or a Mujaddad, and those murids who get the benefit, in the same way your niyyah is the same, you will get the same reward and benefit. So it's a big point here. What do you get when you sit in the company of the Shaykh? This is a big topic. the company of the awliya Allah, the Quran exhorts the Muslimin to sit with the pious people. So what will we get when we sit the walis of Allah? And 30 days people have done this from the beginning of Ramadan, they've stuck. They're not looking at their sins, they're not ashamed, they're just sitting. It doesn't matter what happens, we're going to sit. Let me sit with the Sheikh, in the company of the Sheikh. So how can that person then leave empty handed at the end of Ramadan? But if there's a loser from amongst that group of people who sits with the Sheikh, with the teacher, and he doesn't benefit from the sohbat of the Sheikh, he doesn't understand the words of the Sheikh, it hasn't affected him positively, then that's not company of the wali, of the pious people. Company of the wali means the positive effect comes into your life. The color has come into your life. You sat down, you listened, you understood, and your life's improved. And then Allah Ta'ala gave the second thing, which is dhikr. First point is the company of the wali Allah. Second is dhikr of Allah. So if we attain dhikr, and our heart doesn't change, dunya's in our hearts, and fitna, and fraud, and deceit, and this doesn't come out of our hearts, then we've wasted Ramadan. But the person who's attained the tawbah from these sins, then he's got the darajat in paradise. So you get the company of the Shaykh. Number two, dhikr of Allah. The person in the beginning of Ramadan said, forget the dunya, forget wasting time, I need to do this. And the third thing, Ramadan alhamdulillah is with us, through which we attain everything through the barakah of Ramadan. So Allah Ta'ala has given us such karam and mercy that despite being ill and maybe not healthy, alhamdulillah, Allah Ta'ala from the beginning to the end of Ramadan, he in the same tariqah allowed us to remember him, to worship him. That we didn't miss any salah, we didn't miss any taraweeh, we didn't miss any recitation of Quran, we attended the majalis of dhikr, we had the company of the Shaykh, we went to different masjids and enjoyed the gatherings, we left the sins, the wrong actions. And if we didn't go to gatherings or environments where there was dunya and tribulation and fitna, Allah saved us from those gatherings due to the barakah of Ramadan. Didn't we get the barakah of Ramadan like this? The person who didn't get this or who did get this, put your hands up. So we attained this, all of this, mashallah, and you accept that you got this. The angels say that he has accepted. So Allah Ta'ala says he accepts and he said the right thing. What does Allah Ta'ala say here? On your raising your hand, Allah Ta'ala says that I swear by my respect and my jalal. Allah Ta'ala says, Allahu Akbar, listen to this. Allah Ta'ala says, I promise by my jalal and my respect. If they look after me and remember me, then I will give them the ghafuriyat, ghafar, my sift of ghafar. I will look after them, Allah Ta'ala says. So we looked after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we remembered Allah, we did tawbah, we tried to leave the sins, we made niyyah intention to leave the sins, we cried to Allah, we trembled, Laylatul Qadr came, we appreciated that, Laylatul Qadr, we changed ourselves, our faces, our bodies, our appearances. This Allah Ta'ala says, they remembered me. They valued what I told them because I'm their Rabb, and they accepted my hakams and my laws. If I called something haram, they accepted it as haram. If I define something as honest, they accepted it as truth. If I said something is incorrect, they accepted it as incorrect. This is called believing and accepting. So Allah Ta'ala swears upon this point. You know when Allah Ta'ala swears and promises, this is Allah's jalal that comes into being. Allah Ta'ala's jalal, Allah's power. Allah Ta'ala says, I swear by my respect and my jalal. This is written in the kitab, this dua. So alhamdulillah, the sadiq people like you, honest, sincere, and I'm just here trying to get along and jump on the wagon that you're on, mashallah. So all brothers who are here and who are online, listen to the majalis and sat for 30 days. Yes, if it's for the sake of Allah, if you thought about me and had regard for me and remembered me, Allah Ta'ala says. So brothers, the end is here, the culmination is here, that our situation will change after a few hours. We should not face defeat. We should face life the same way as we have in these past days. Because Allah Ta'ala gave us ease in Ramadan. Allah gave us hunger. Yes, Allah gave us thirst. We did crush our desires. And after a few hours, they're going to come who have destroyed the whole world. They're going to come. And they've got their workers. They kept on doing their work in Ramadan. Their workers, they didn't leave their work in different places. They tried. The workers, but the head, the king, he's about to be released. Shaitan. Wretched shaitan. He will be here in the next hour or two. He's preparing his tools and his methods. And he's saying now to himself, watch me after Ramadan. I'm going to catch these so-called believers. But what are we? We also ready. You come out and we're going to come out. We've done dhikr of Allah. You come with your plan. Allah Ta'ala has given us that tool that you can come with all your preparation, Iblis. But inshallah, we will not let you break our tawbah. Whenever your whispers come to us, straight we're going to go to the company of our Shaykh. We will do dhikr of Allah. And this will be the practice. With the promises we made to Allah, that you've made, when whispering of shaitan comes, love of dunya comes, we have to get out of the dunya. We're in the masjid at the moment, we're doing dhikr, we're protected, we're like angels. We think we're angels, but when we leave the masjid and go into the open playing field, when we go to work, our business, dunya, meeting, interaction, wife, children, they'll come from now, you'll start eating. Before you used to eat one samosa, now you'll have 10 samosas after Ramadan. And where, mashallah, you used to have a few dates and depart, now you're going to wait, the food's coming, and dishes, and three course meals, etc. You're not going to leave the stomach, are we? We're going to fill it up after Ramadan. This is what we're going to do, isn't it? But there's a beautiful technique and cure that Allah Ta'ala has given to us. That you will save yourself and keep your tawbah consistent. You will maintain it throughout the rest of your life. Our tawbah will be saved, inshallah. And you will feel like you're in Ramadan for the rest of the year until the next Ramadan comes. How? Whenever you do any action, and you do it according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then shaitan won't come close to you. You're taking your shoes off, take the shoes off according to the sunnah. Change your clothes according to the sunnah. Going inside your house according to the sunnah. Every action you do, then think, what is the sunnah? Analyze. When you're about to do an action, how did Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam do this action? And shaitan will have not even a crack to enter into your iman. If you implement all your deeds, sitting in the car, driving, transportation, coming out of the car, sleeping, waking up, what is the sunnah this time? What did Rasulullah ﷺ do at this time? What did he say this time? How did he do this at this time? How did he meet the people at this time? So just analyze, do hisab, do accounting of every deed. Inshallah, until the day of judgment, shaitan will not come near you. He will not come near, he will not dare. Shaitan, he becomes blind when he sees sunnah. He becomes blind. He says, who are these people? The sparkle, the glow from top to bottom, the body. The more you are apparent and inward, physical and spiritual on sunnah. Because he seeks from above. He says, I come from above, from behind, from in front, everywhere. Allah Ta'ala has given us sunnah from all directions. From above, he's given us the great sunnah of the imam. Above. That one sunnah, shaitan cannot compete. When those people who have got imama on the head, the sunnah, shaitan cannot imagine to come near us. So why do we need to worry about him? Such a nur comes from the head of a person when he wears imama. Alhamdulillah, that those who have reality vision, they see the reality of the nur. Such nur of this sunnah, that Allah Ta'ala, whenever he sent the angels to the earth, they came down wearing imamas, the angels. And the angels, they probably asked, Allah, why do you give us this libas when we descend to the earth? Why do you make us wear the imamah, the turban? And maybe Allah Ta'ala answered them, the foolish people, don't you understand that you are still stuck, that from Adam you had that clash with Adam, and that's why I give you this libas, because you're going to the earth where my Habib wore this libas on the earth, so you need to wear that same libas. The Sahaba wore the libas, so you go in that same libas. You're descending to the earth, to the portion where Rasulullah lived, so you also wear the libas that he preferred, that I prefer. We are ummatis, we are followers. So will we wear this? Will we wear this, brothers? Yes. So from today, that if you want to get the benefit, otherwise we'll complain, Allah, I don't have nur and barakah. You can run after mal and wealth. You can recite as many Qurans as you want and blow them on your body. But if we don't have sunnah in our life, we cannot defeat shaitan. Shaitan. Quran will also stop its effect after Ramadan. Even the Quran is obedient to the sunnah. Everything was made due to the sunnah. If we think, what is it? Sunnah is the tariqah, the method of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Quran, what is Quran reading? It's sunnah. Who taught us reading Quran? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. And it's sunnah. So is sunnah first or is fard first? Who taught us about we have to pray salah? Who taught us and physically demonstrated salah? So sunnah came first, then came fard. This is a logical word I'm giving to you here. That everything that we do in our life, there's the sunnah way of doing it. And nothing negative will affect us. Some people come and ask me, can you give me taweez or wazifa, jinns inside me or my house? Yes, evil forces do this, and you recite something and blow on that person, then he becomes daif again. This is all drama and games against evil. But the asal tool, you don't need anything to blow on you or jinnat or magic or potions. There's wahid, one tool that will ward off all evil in life. Sunnat Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the greatest force from top to bottom, outward to inward. Enter into the sunnah in the same way. Qamiz, wear qamiz. Yes, wear the kurta, the qamiz. What was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's qamiz? It was wide. It used to have the slit on the sides, and there was the buttons, and always Rasulullah's top button was open. He never closed his top button. Yes, and mostly his clothes were white. And at the bottom, on the top he had the qamis, the kurta, and below that he had the lungi, the dhoti sharif, or the izhar, as we say. This was the libas. Not that, why didn't you call it fard? If it's fard, then I will wear it. If it's a must, then I will wear it. No. But they left it, Allah Ta'ala left it to our whims and desires. If you wear it, if you implement the sunnah, you will be free. If you wear it, then from below you'll be protected. On top you have imamah, you'll be protected from above. If you're in front, shaitan can't come in front. You have the qamis from the rear, from behind, from the left and right. The whole of your heart is protected from the sunnah of Rasulullah. So brothers, live this life easy, relaxed, nicely. Ward off shaitan. Defend yourself from shaitan. How best? Follow the sunnah. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's your choice after that. If you implement, fine. If you imitate me, fine. You will live the life first class. No black magic on you. No jinn on you. No shaitan. You will sleep nicely and easy. If you follow this sunnah, then your whole tawbah you made in Ramadan, it will continue, will maintain itself until qiyamah. When you rise from the grave, alhamdulillah, Allah will announce, cool them, the people of sunnah, that you sat down in Ramadan and promised you will implement the sunnah in your life, and you from that day you followed the sunnah. That's it. Cool those people. Yes, when you eat, eat according to the sunnah. Don't drink away from the sunnah example. Everything, all day, all night, every action and breath of a Muslim in his life can be done according to sunnah. Even now you're sitting, sit according to sunnah. Do you know how to sit? When a person sits with a teacher in a majlis, what is the tariqah? The person who sits incorrect, he will not get the benefit. The person who sits in the right way will get the benefit. There's the way of sitting. You can sit like you want, leaning against the wall, lean against the floor, lie down, breathe heavily, sigh. No, this is not the adab of the majlis. The biggest adab is the sheikh, the way he's sitting, sit in that way. That's the adab. If you have come to get faiz and benefit from the teacher, if you sit incorrectly, rudely, without respect, you won't get the faiz, the respect. So if you carry on doing the bad actions, then you will get nothing. You will leave with the empty bag. So in every method, there's a sunnah way. The sahaba ikram, how did they sit in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? What was their method? How did they speak? How did they watch him? How did they look at him? How did they address him? Have we learned this? No, no. I'm Baya, and I'm a student, and I'm doing dhikr. No. You have to have adab. The adab, when a person goes to his teacher, he goes to make his life. The objective of a student to sit with his teacher, I put my hand in the hand of my sheikh. I didn't ask him about the shock. Don't commit dramas and play acts. No dunya, no akhirah will be attained. I swear by Allah. Be on one side and be sincere. No dunya or akhirah will be attained. If we go 50-50, two-faced hypocrisy, Allah Ta'ala says, all our actions in our life are for Allah Ta'ala's sake. Ramadan we passed and worship for Allah Ta'ala's sake. So grab hold of Allah Ta'ala's hand and see what happens after. Poverty, hunger, difficulties. In my life, such a hard time came. Not just once, many times. Rather, a year came. All I had was £10 left over at the end of the week. £10. It was hard. My accountant used to say, you're earning so much. Where are you going to eat from? Where are you going to drink from? How are you going to spend? You're giving the tax and you're giving your dues. Ask him, phone him up. I said, I will eat, Allah will give. Definitely. But their share, I have to give them their rights. I did not compromise. So he tried so hard, people who were learned. And they said that, look, so a person has to persevere through the difficulties in the path of Allah. The Sahaba Ikram, the noble companions, gave us the example that the difficult time will come. It will come. But to save their feet, they had nothing. They had no slippers. The hukum was come on, we've got to go on an expedition, on a journey. So what did they do? They tore their cloth on their body. And they took the cloth and body, they tore it up into strips, and they wrapped those strips around the soles of the feet. Because if you walk on the hot desert sand, it's hotter than fire. And miles, they travel without food and drink. But did they ever dare to leave salah? Did they ever complain on their tongue to Allah? The Allah is too hot, Allah, I can't walk, Allah, I'm thirsty, hungry. We don't need Jannah, Allah. We don't need Deen. I'm about to die, Allah. Where am I going to eat from? When am I going to drink from? When am I going to earn from? Where's dunya going to come from, Allah? Where's the luxury going to come from? Am hasibtum yadkhulul Jannah? Allah Ta'ala questions and asks in the Quran, do you think Jannah is easy? It's a cheap bargain? You think you will just walk laughing into Jannah without any struggle? Just enjoy yourself, luxuries, and play games and deceive like today people do? You think Jannah is something insignificant? And when a person gets Jannah, Allah says, Am hasibtum yadkhulul Jannah. That those people, they weren't seeking Jannah. But when the hukum come for them, this is a key point. Listen here carefully. There's a point coming here. The Sahaba Ikram, great noble individuals, they weren't seeking Jannah. They didn't care about Jannah, paradise. And for them Allah Ta'ala says that, do you think Jannah is easy? And what were they seeking? They were seeking Allah Ta'ala's pleasure, Allah Ta'ala's happiness. That's what they were seeking. And how much should we then run after and make effort? You brothers, mashallah, here who are Sufis, what are you looking for running after? Allah Ta'ala's pleasure. Rida ilahi. Allah's pleasure. So do we, when we have problems and difficulties and distress in life, and for all of this we leave the path? Just because life's a bit hard? Don't you understand what I'm saying? So Ramadan's going, it's departing. I'm just trying to go over the whole subject matter. Can conclude the conclusion I'm trying to present today. The conclusion, the summary. You know when you wring the cloth and the drops come out, it's fard on me. My sheikh said, go and with your murid and sit down. And my hukam would come through that letter that speak nicely and lovingly to your murids. Because this is the sunnah of Rasulullah SAW. This is a hukam in the Quran. Rasulullah SAW gave that direction, that be shafiq. Love and have gentleness and affection with your students. And distribute to them nicely. And give them affection. Otherwise I could say, oh, I'll do what I want and you do what you want. But this isn't the case. In every sitting, alhamdulillah, I gave you a new fruit, a new teaching, a new link. So should you have shukr for this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? That Allah ta'ala is explaining to us like children, just like a father or a teacher. What are we trying to save ourselves from? Jahannam, shaitan, haram, unlawful actions, haram actions, sins, zina, deception, enmity, fighting with people, killing people, quarreling, disputes. And what's Allah giving? Jannah, paradise, His pleasure, Allah's vision, Allah's sight. So this is what we talk about in these gatherings. Do you understand my point I'm making? So this is the situation. So Allah Ta'ala says, I swear by my jalal and my respect that the person who has regard for me and remembers me, I will give regard to him and I will not leave him. He won't be have any issues. Allah, if we say, Allah, we believe in you, what's the worst case scenario if we suffer? Obviously, we'll die out of hunger, poverty. If we have a difficulty physically in life, worst case scenario, we'll pass away, isn't it? Allah Ta'ala. But we say to Allah, that Allah, the end of the difficulty, how does maut come for a person who's struggling in life? But maut comes when the difficulty finishes. And I was thinking that there was like the growling in my stomach, and I'm thinking, I went to the doctor. Because I tell you my personal events. So I thought, let me see how does death come. Let me taste this event of death. What's the hair? La yukallifu nafsan illa wusaha. What does this mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What pain do you give to a person? To what limit extreme? So I went to the doctor, I sat down, and I had pain, and the pain increased. And the doctor was like me. He was a little bit of a, you know, he grabbed hold of this and my vein, and he was trying to analyze and diagnose, and the pain increased. And I thought, how worse will this pain become? Allah says, La yukallifu nafsan illa wusaha. This was his surgery. I was sitting there, he's looking at me, he's my friend. And he's trying to diagnose the issue. He said, what's happened, Hazrat? He kept on asking. I said, look, the pain is there, and the pain was increasing, and the pain reached to the height, and it was severe pain. And then suddenly, I fell down and I was unconscious. And after that, what was my condition? I tell you, Allahu Akbar. That so much sakina and peace overcame me, and in my ears was a noise that he's passed away. Quickly, call the ambulance with the red light. I remember that. He said to his secretary, call the ambulance with the red siren, with the red color siren signal. The flashing lights. And I'm hearing this. And he was taking my blood pressure and he's saying, no, he's finished, he's passed away. And everyone around is saying, oh, he's passed away. And then I think, just for a few seconds, Allah Ta'ala showed me the effect of death. There was so much sakina and peace. And when I got up, all of my illness was zahir. Wallahi. That everything had disappeared. There was no pain. And before that, I was so much in pain. And I could have been finished. I could have died. I said, alhamdulillah, you've shown me that what happens at the time of death. What is maut in reality? When that is the end point. The final point of pain. After the Allah Ta'ala's meeting comes with His creation. And the ambulance came. And they grabbed me by force. And the ambulance came at the time. They were a bit shocked that he's alive. He's still alive. And they said, we thought you died, and we called the ambulance. They took me, put me in the ambulance, and I'm doing dhikr of Allah. I lied down, and there was a brother with me. And they took me to the hospital. And they said, everything's fine, we've tested you, you're healthy just like before. I said, okay, please let me go, and I went back home. So this is the story of life. Ups and downs. These things happen. So why do we enjoy ourselves breaking Allah Ta'ala's laws? Allah has given us such a great wealth. We've done tawbah, we've repented, we've left the sins. Have we left the sins? MashaAllah, we've left the sins. Such a gift and ni'mah. We would never have got this in a normal life. Allah Ta'ala made us commit and make promises. Allah, we won't do wrong actions, evil actions. All the brothers who heard have promised to leave their sins. Allah Ta'ala, we will leave our life with poverty, hunger and difficulty. We will not wilt, we will not shake, we won't be scared of hunger and poverty and thirst. Allah, we will not disobey you though. We will follow your deen. What is this? Such a big gift and reward Allah Ta'ala has given us. Wealth, that's it. That's all we need. Allah Ta'ala has sworn also, don't worry my servant. I will be ghafar with you and saqtar with you. You will be poor and people will look down at you, but you will be the richest at the same time. This happens, alhamdulillah. You will be poor, but people will think you're the wealthiest. Like my Hadhrat Sheikh. They don't have anything physical, material, but the people of the world think he's the luckiest, and that's why people of the world come to the fakir and say, can you do dua for me? Do dua for me. Please give me something, dua. He has nothing, but they come and ask him to do dua. The wali wala wai, because Allah Ta'ala says, he's my friend and he's got all of the riches of the universe. So if today we do true tawbah, Allah will make us the same. If Allah is Sattar, Allah is Ghaffar, then that person doesn't remain normal. He becomes the Wali of Allah. Every one of us can be a Wali of Allah. So Allah, may Allah Ta'ala give us all tawfiq. There are a few moments left of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, the final moments, seconds, minutes, we'll remember Allah and we'll do dhikr, 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 and we'll say Khuda Hafiz, and we'll say salam to Al-Wida, to Ramadan. And inshallah, if we have life, then we'll have sohbat and we'll have the good gatherings. And inshallah, if we stay alive, then the majalis of Ramadan will continue next year. Remember me in your du'as. Never forget me. Please, what you heard in Ramadan, do dua for me, that I can also do amal on this. I am weak, I'm not strong. I have done tawbah as well, that I will change and improve. May Allah give me tawfiq to be consistent, and may you remain consistent. But let me tell you the main thing. The main thing, three things grab in your life. Conclusion today. Three things. Number one, afdal, great way of pray salah in jama'ah, in congregation. Never leave. Do you promise this? Say inshallah. If there's a force, sharia excuse, then that's fine, but never leave. This is the final promise. Salah, prayer, in congregation, in the masjid. Number one promise. Never leave this. Promise. You will try your best, you will run. Make haste, I have to go to masjid. You speak honestly the truth, you promise, say inshallah. Number two, you will live your life according to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whatever you know and what you don't know, learn it. If you have not got the ilm, the knowledge, then learn it. But if you know these actions, X, Y, Z, A, B, C, this is sunnah, then implement the sunnah in your life. And number three, dhikr of Allah, embrace the dhikr of Allah. Don't grab it, embrace it. Hug it, squeeze it, face to face, neck to neck. And grab hold of the dhikr of Allah, embrace it from the neck and squeeze it and don't let it go. You know when your beloved friend comes to your house and you embrace him, you say, oh brother, I'm not going to leave him, we'll leave you. And inshallah, you grab hold of dhikr. If you have these three things, this Ramadan, inshallah, will continue like this for you until the hereafter. May Allah Ta'ala give us these three things and give us the tawfiq to implement these. Ameen. Recite the Durood Sharif.